Good morning and welcome to the 17th meeting in 2023 of the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee. And we've received apologies from Annie Wells and Marie McNair. May I remind all members and witnesses to ensure that their devices are on silent and that all other notifications are turned off during the meeting. The first item on our agenda today is to decide whether to take items 4, 5, 6 and 7 in private. Are members agreed? We're all agreed. Thank you. We now turn to agenda item 2, which is to take evidence on the recent Accounts Commission report, Local Government in Scotland, Overview 2023. And we're joined today by members of the Accounts Commission. That's Andrew Burns, who's a member, and Tim Mackay, who is the interim deputy chair. And also from Audit Scotland, we are joined by Carol Calder, who's the audit director, Anthony Clark, who's the Executive Director of Performance Audit and Best Value, and Lucy Jones, who's the Audit Manager. And I now invite Tim Mackay to make a short opening statement before I open to questions from members.
Thank you, Convener. And on behalf of the Accounts Commission, thank you, Committee, for inviting us here to discuss the overview report. Councils have never faced such a challenging situation. Their finances are under severe strain, with cost pressures increasing and funding increasingly ring-fenced. They've had to make significant savings to balance their budgets, and they're still facing difficult choices about spending priorities and service provision. The pandemic adversely affected performance across all service areas, and there are signs of growing backlogs and declining performance in some areas, including adult social care, housing and homelessness. Councils do have a clear focus on tackling inequalities, but the extent and impact of their citizens' needs not being met are unclear. Some communities are facing crisis, experiencing persistently high levels of poverty and increasing financial hardship at a time when councils have less capacity to support them. Workforce pressures have deepened, with record levels of staff sickness absence and increasing recruitment challenges due to the competitive labour market. The scale of the challenges, with funding forecasts to reduce in real terms and demographic and workforce pressures growing, mean that Scotland's councils must radically change how they operate, particularly how they collaborate with their partners if services to communities are to be maintained and national priorities tackled. During the pandemic, many councils showed strong collaborative leadership and demonstrated the benefits of a place-based approach and of working closely with partners and communities, focusing on the vulnerable, reducing bureaucracy, and using the workforce in flexible ways. These experiences must be consolidated and built upon. In our report, we're clear that leaders must take urgent action, but we recognise that this is not going to be easy. The level of uncertainty and immediate financial pressures make planning and delivering sustainable change much more difficult. In our best value reports and individual councils, we've seen that the quality of leadership and the pace and appetite for change varies. The current challenges may reinforce this gap, with the risk that some councils will be left behind. Shared services and shared administrative functions offer efficiencies and can help to manage recruitment pressures and skills shortages, but councils have made limited progress in providing these to date. And tensions with central government and delays to agreeing the New Deal create risks to councils' ability to make fundamental changes at the pace needed. Reform will have a huge impact on communities and the workforce. Councils must be open and clear with both groups about the need for change, what that means for future service delivery, and involve communities in making these difficult decisions. The recommendations in our report are directed to both councillors and senior officers, who must set the tone, make the difficult decisions and implement radical change. I'd like to draw out just one key recommendation to enable that change, which is for COSLA and the Scottish Government, as part of the New Deal, to agree a fiscal framework. This is long overdue, and doing this should give councils long-term financial stability and flexibility to support them in making their difficult decisions and making the fundamental changes urgently needed. Thank you, and my colleagues and I are very happy to answer any questions.
Thanks very much for that. I was going to ask you if the overview showed any significant changes in local government situation, both in finance and performance. But in a way, you've kind of laid that out already. But I'll ask another supplementary question to that, and then in response, you can pull out anything else you want to highlight beyond the recommendation on the fiscal framework. So given that the Scottish Government has allocated a total of £13.5 billion to local government this financial year, that's up 3.5% in real terms since 2013-14, could you set out why council budgets are now under such severe strain?
Yes, the settlement you referenced is increasing slightly in real terms, but if you look further forward, the funding settlement is flat, essentially. And with the cost of living crisis and the high inflation we're experiencing just now, that is going to mean real-term decline in council funding.
Thanks for that. I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on any highlights around the significant changes before I move on. Don't have to. Anthony, yeah.
I'm just going to make the point that Tim's quite right about the impact of inflation and the pressures that creates for local authorities on both the revenue funding and the capital funding. We also need to see this alongside the increasing demand for local government services as well. Mm. I mean, the COVID-19 pandemic is not behind us entirely, and they're still having to deal with quite significant pressures on services associated with that. We know that we're living through a cost of living crisis for local authorities, so the community demands on local government services and other services are increasing as well. So all of that, I think, is piling pressure on local authority finances. Mm.
Yeah, thanks for highlighting that. There's so many bits to this, isn't there, to keep track of. I'd be interested to hear, so we, you know, as you're aware, and some of you were there, maybe all of you were there, we held a great event with the Futures Forum on local and government relationships, and a number of people there told us that local government is often seen as the delivery arm of central government rather than its true partner. And I'd be interested to hear your thoughts on how a new deal could change this and support a relationship based on trust. What could a new deal mean for communities, for the communities that local government serves?
Thanks, Convener. I'm happy to answer that. I mean, I was at that event and I agree it was a very worthwhile event and I enjoyed the morning. And I look forward to future work coming out of the Scottish Futures Forum on this issue. I mean, I would just draw everybody's attention to page 30 of our overview report this year, where we have some detailed information about the potential new deal, which is a partnership agreement which would include a fiscal framework. I mean, collectively as a Commission and also Audit Scotland, you'll have heard us both individually and collectively go on about this at quite some length on various visits to this committee, other committees. It was mentioned during the session you just referenced, Convener, as well. The partnership framework has been discussed for several years now, and it does build on further reviews of local governance frameworks and so on. So it really is imperative now, we sense, as a Commission and Audit Scotland, that the partnership agreement is delivered. And what it could do, if it's delivered in accordance with what you see being the anticipated three elements on page 30 of a report, is it could outline a complete change in tone, which might sound like a minor thing, but it could be quite significant if the language changes from levels of government to spheres of government, and if there is parity of esteem. We've all heard that statement and that phrase endlessly over the years, but actually making it a reality has been a bit elusive, frankly, we sense as a Commission, and the evidence that we get from our best value reports that Tim, our convener, our interim chair has already mentioned, shows that parity of esteem is often not there in reality on the ground. So the partnership agreement, which we understand, and you'll be as close to this as possible we are, could provide a change in tone, a change in language, and set the scene for, as I say, more aspects of spheres of government being the language that's used as opposed to levels of government, and potentially followed up very, it has to be followed up, I would suggest, very quickly by a fiscal framework that actually addresses the funding arrangements and settlements for local government. And again, just drawing your attention before I finish, Convener, back to page 30, you'll see that we were anticipating that, as well as the partnership agreement and the fiscal framework, that there would be a working group set up to look at the funding arrangements for local government. Now, I don't know about you, but I sort of sigh internally when I hear talk of another working group, because there's been so much work done on this over the years. And I guess we would just make a plea from the Commission, Audit Scotland's perspective, that whatever does come out of the partnership agreement and hopefully a fiscal framework thereafter, that any funding arrangements are looked at extremely quickly and we do not reinvent the wheel. Mm-hmm. Because there's been numerous studies on this that show that there are ways fairly quickly that the level of funding that's available to local government could be significantly raised from the sort of 15 to 18% of revenue that it's responsible for raising itself just now through the council tax. And again, without repeating evidence we've given before, you know, Scotland, the UK, is an outlier in this regard. Most local authority levels of, or spheres of government, I should say, on the continent raise between 40 to 50% of their own revenue. And that's certainly an aspiration that is not just it's not just an aspiration, it's achievable here in Scotland as well quite quickly. And previous reports show how it could be done. Mm. Hope that helps.
That's super. And I don't think we should be any concerned about repeating anything in this committee. I think we just need to repeat it until it comes through. So I really appreciate your response. And I think highlighting the fact that we are an outlier, and in the EU we've got this 40 to 50% ability for local authorities to raise the revenue. But I do think the message is getting through on spheres. I asked a question of the First Minister at the convener group question time, and he did use the word spheres in his response. It is that bit, though, I think that, as you say, it sets the tone, but how do we move to that point where we actually put the action in under the tone? So it's something about, when I think about spheres, it's something about getting real clarity, and I think this, again, came through at the New Deal event, was real clarity around who's responsible for what areas and who has that power and that that fiscal responsibility there. So that's something else I think we'll be looking for. But definitely, I think page 30 of your report is going to get scrutinised heavily now.
Well, that's good to hear.
Thanks for that. Willie, you've got some questions.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning, everyone. I wonder if I could pick your brains and get your thoughts on the importance of financial planning information and how that supports decision-making. It's often discussed with my colleagues from Audit Scotland at the Audit Committee, but it's playing an increasingly important part in the work we do. It was just to tease out with you, what do you mean? Could you exemplify what you mean by more detailed financial information to support the councils? Could you perhaps exemplify for the committee what we mean by that? And I'll maybe start with Tim and Andrew and then ask my Audit Scotland colleagues to
continue. Sure. Well, the detail, there are two elements to the detail. One is having a longer term financial horizon so that councils, instead of getting a definite figure just for 1 year, can have, say, a 3 year series of settlements so that they know exactly what they're getting over 3 years. And the other element is a transparent funding model. So not only do they know what they're getting, but they know on what basis it's been calculated. So that they are able to plan ahead, bearing in mind that, say, some element of funding is based on population growth, they can at least have some idea of what they are going to get based on their own estimates of population growth or number of children or whatever many factors are put into the funding model.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Tim. Andrew?
I think the only thing I would highlight, Willie, briefly, just before I hand over to Carol, is to emphasise the point Tim's just made about longer-term horizon for planning. We've got to break out, I think, collectively as a nation from this cycle of saying, well, we can't give you a three-year budget framework because we don't get it from the next sphere or the next level of government. I think that type of, all the evidence we've seen over the years just indicates to us that type of, blame game just has to stop, and that local authorities have got to be given three-year settlements, whether the Scottish Government gets a three-year settlement or not, frankly, and because it would allow very, very significant certainty around, much more certainty now, around detailed financial planning that often isn't possible at the moment. Because many local authorities, and our best value reports show this, many local authorities do produce three-year, five-year, I think there's one or two produce a 10-year budget plan. Now, it's just a forward plan, but they do that receiving a one-year settlement from the Scottish Government. So I guess I would just really stress that if we can break the cycle of, well, we can't deliver a three-year budget horizon because we don't get it from the level of government above us or next to us, it would make a huge difference if we could just let go a bit and commit to a 3 to 5 year horizon in terms of planning. But Carol and others may want to add to that.
Just before, Carol, would that be indicative budgets, Andrew, or would that be guaranteed? How do they do this? Because if something was to happen and you couldn't deliver the second or the third year, what happens then?
Well, I think what most local authorities are doing, so the ones that have got 3, 5, I think there are one or two that have got 10, they do at the moment, is they obviously set a hard and fast budget for the year ahead. But then the other budgets are potentially just indicative. That might be the wrong detailed phrase, but they are indicative. They can flex. So they can flex in years 2, 3, or 3, 4, 5. And obviously they do and have to flex in years 8, 9, and 10 for the odd one or two authorities, commendable local authorities who have got 10-year frameworks. But that really does help, as our interim chair was indicating, really does help for future forward planning if that framework, even if it is indicative, is there.
OK. Carol, what is that more detail that we need?
I was going to say councils need to be planning on three different horizons, dealing with the here and now, the shorter-term priorities, and then the longer-term priorities. And you're asked why it's important. If they haven't got the information to allow them to plan for a longer-term horizon, we'll never shift to a prevention early intervention approach. So that's why it's really important. And as others have said, it's about having certainty over a longer time period, but it's also about not having funding coming in year. So there's an awful lot of fragmented funding that comes into councils, all of which have responsibilities for monitoring and reporting too, which take up a lot of officer time, which is not a very efficient way of doing it. But if it was clearer and less fragmented, then I think that we would see that councils were better able to forward plan around prevention and early intervention, and we could start to see a shift from that kind of reaction focus to prevention focus.
Mm-hmm. And what about the resource spending review itself? Does that help, hinder?
It didn't have a lot of detail in it, and I think medium-term financial strategy that came out last month was indicating that the figures in the resource spending review will be refreshed, so we don't know what change there's going to be across the different budget groups because of that, but it didn't provide sufficient information for councils to know, well, how much am I getting? So what can I do with that? So I think it's a step forward, but it still needs a bit more detail to allow councils to do what I described, which is to look forward, to invest, to save. And at the moment, they can't. They're frustrated or limited in their ability to do that.
Okay, thanks very much.
Just wanted to build briefly on the question around the medium-term financial plan and the strategy. It did operate at a level that was above that would be required to give councils confidence about different policy commitment areas and levels of funding for local authorities. And the consequence of the short-term budget-setting process, the annual funding, means that councils find it very difficult, as you'll know from evidence previously given to the committee, to fund others as well. I mean, it means that if you're trying to support the third sector, which is a really important partner for local government, you know, one-year funding for the third sector makes it very difficult to employ staff, invest in new services. The committee will know that the local government and their partners are committed to long-term outcomes, the prevention agenda that Carol mentioned. By definition, long-term outcomes require long-term investment and long-term planning. So therefore, the failure to have a system that gives people certainty or a higher degree of certainty about the future makes it much more difficult to deliver those new services, transformation and planning for long-term outcomes. Mm.
Thank you for that. A favourite question I have when I have Audit Scotland colleagues in the room is, like, how will we ever know that your comments, suggestions, recommendations or otherwise are implemented and successful if we're sitting here again next year or the year after and we look back at these recommendations? What would we expect to see for you to say, they took that on board and they carried that through? What would you expect?
Well, number one would be a fiscal framework.
Okay. With longer term
figures, with more certainty, to allow the long term planning and all the things my colleagues have talked about,
and more of the detail, Carol, within the spending reviews that gives up a bit more clarity. So we expect to see that to, to evidence the recommendations that you're suggesting have been carried forward.
Well, I hope next year there will be a new deal that we can refer to. I think there's other things that we need to think about as well. When we do an annual overview, it's every year. So some of the problems that are facing local government are societal problems that are not going to shift markedly over the period of 12 months. So sometimes we have to kind of look at impact over that longer term as well. But what we'd hope to see is the mechanics of managing and planning and looking at different ways to deliver services will be visible over the shorter term.
Thanks for that. And last question from me. It's an important one, I think, though. It's about something called service rationing. Are you seeing any evidence of that? And by that we mean things like unmet demand increasing, perhaps, or eligibility criteria to get certain services being changed because of the budget situation. Are you seeing any evidence of that, or shifting budgets to push them towards other priorities and less in other matters? Are you seeing any examples of that, Tim?
We are. Anthony may have some more detailed.
Yes, Ms. Coffey, this is not a new issue. The issue of the tightening of eligibility criteria for some important local government services has been happening for quite some time, given the financial pressure facing local authorities. The Commission wrote a report on social work services in Scotland several years ago now, and as part of that report, we looked at the eligibility criteria across all 32 local authorities. And at that time, to access social care services, people had to present with the highest level of need. So we were asking questions then about the extent to which the eligibility criteria in place for many social care services, whether or not they were supportive of the prevention agenda. Because if you have to present in largely a crisis situation, that clearly runs counter to the prevention agenda. That's one example where fiscal and financial pressures have tightened the eligibility for an important service. We know as well that in some other important services, levels of access in terms of opening hours, patterns of provision have been changing. I think in the report, the overview report, we talk about there being uncertainty about what this means across all local government services. It's certainly something the Accounts Commission and Audit Scotland are looking at quite closely, because we want to make sure that when councils make these important decisions about prioritisation and choices, that there's a sense of understanding what that impact will be on communities. It's a really important question, Mr. Coffey.
And has there been Tim?
Oh, sorry, I was just going to add that paragraph 23 references a Solace survey which identifies some of the services most under pressure. Sorry, just to...
Thank you. Carol?
Just a brief addition to that is, I think we're always banging the drum, but we'll bang it again, is the need for data. So we have anecdotal evidence from councils, from services, from chief executives that they're having to, they have an unmet need in their service areas. But there's difficulty in quantifying that and being transparent about that. And that's one of the recommendations of the report, that councils develop better information so that they can be clearer and open with their communities about what the unmet need is and where backlogs lie.
Mm-hmm. Any time scale on that we could look forward to reading, and then perhaps next year to have a full impact assessment on that unmet need?
We'll certainly be looking at it again. It's okay. One of the recommendations, so we'll be following up on the recommendations.
Okay. Thank you very much for answering those questions.
Thanks, Willie. Now going to move to questions from Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I wanted to ask a couple of questions with regards to some of the spending which you put within the report. And what stood out for me was significant reductions in council spending on planning, culture, leisure services and environmental services over the last decade. And I just wondered what impact these have had on local communities and local businesses, but also some of the changes we've seen, for example, the use of ALIOs. Has that actually helped, or has that been a way of just trying to transfer this money off council budgets? So I wanted to start on that and move on to a few other things.
Well, you're referencing Exhibit 1, which identifies the individual areas that you're talking about. I don't know, Carol, if you want to give some evidence on what that means specifically for specific services.
So, yes, the trends are really quite stark, and they're not overnight. This has been a long-term trend. So some of those services have almost or over 30% reduction in funding and reductions in staff. What that means for communities is So your planning applications might take a bit longer because your planning department's cut to the bone. Internally, your workforce planning and looking to manage your workforce into the future may be inhibited by the fact that you've cut your core central services and you haven't got the capacity in HR and OD to do that kind of forward planning about what kind of skills you need in the future. So it inhibits councils in the ability to deliver services in those areas because there are less people to deliver them. And I think in planning, the income from planning doesn't come anywhere near, from planning applications doesn't come anywhere near to the costs. So yes, it is impacting on performance in those service areas. And the other thing you asked about was LEOs. Of course, LEOs have been greatly affected by the pandemic, and we still don't know the recovery of that. We did a piece of work on how councils work around LEOs, which talks about the governance of LEOs and the importance of monitoring and making sure that we're getting value for money through those arm's length organisations. But the impact on leisure and culture services, for instance, has been immense over the pandemic. So I think there's a lot of unknowns in that area.
Thank you for that. And would you say, you know, looking at these have been kind of low-hanging fruit where councils have been able to cut them. We've just completed some work with regards to National Planning Framework 4, and a big part of that was actually the planning department's not functioning properly, not having the workforce in place. Now, that's potentially now changing, but we've seen that decade of people lost to a very important part of our local government planning system. So just wondered, has this just been an area where councils have been forced to target because key statutory services maybe are needing funded instead?
Andrew, do you want to?
Yeah, maybe if I kick off, and I think Andy and Carol might come in with some more detail. I mean, I don't know if you're getting at this, Miles, directly, but I think you raised an important point about the link to what you've asked to ring fencing and the directive nature of the core budgets for local authorities. I mean, I can't remember the exact figure, colleagues will tell me, but it's about two-thirds. It's huge for education and social care of most local authorities' budgets. It's soaked up by those two services. All of the ones you've just asked about are outside of that and form a much smaller part of any of the 32 overall local authorities' budgets. And there's been more and more direction on those two central services, education and social care. And that has led, undoubtedly, indirectly, to significant pressure on the remaining 30-odd percent of services, all of the ones you've just listed. So I'm not sure I would say it's been low-hanging fruit. It's almost been a result of the increasing amount of direction and ring-fencing. And I know we debated this last time, I think we were here, about the actual percentage of ring-fencing. I mean, I don't want really to be down that rabbit hole, but I think hopefully we could just all agree that there is an increasing amount of ring-fencing, and the specific figure really shouldn't overly trouble us. It's just that there is more and more of it happening. And if that decreased, then it would free up local authorities' ability to be much more flexible on the services that you've just referenced, which are under significant pressure.
Yeah, I'm afraid that Andrew made the point I was just going to make, so I don't want to repeat it, if that's okay.
Right. No, not at all. And on the flip side of that, then, is looking at what the report states with regards to adult social care. You say being specifically in crisis. Now, the report also shows that spend by councils on adult social care has risen real terms by 25% since 2012. So I just wondered again, looking at some of the reforms we've seen, like integration of health and social care, and what is record amounts of money going into the sector, why performance is going in the wrong direction? Now, every member of this committee knows I always raise the Edinburgh issue, but you know, we now have 25% of all delayed discharge here in the capital. So something is clearly not working beyond workforce issues. So just wondered if you had more detail of where you think what is a 25% increase is actually not delivering any better outcome.
Lucy, can I answer that?
Yeah. So you're absolutely right that spending has increased, but at the same time demand has increased, and it's not just demand in terms of numbers, it's that it's an ageing population. The percentage of those that are over 65 has increased, as well as the complexity of cases. So it's that aspect. So adult social care is actually, in terms of home care, is delivering more hours than it ever has before. So I think what you may be seeing is that in terms of the performance indicators, it's a system that's probably at capacity and has been at capacity for quite a while. It's increasing as much as it can. You've got a workforce that has really struggles with recruitment and retention problems, probably feels undervalued. There has been increases in terms of their wages, but I think there's still issues there around a workforce feeling undervalued. We see that satisfaction has declined. So although there is a huge amount of effort and work put into delivering and during the pandemic maintaining those services, overall what you're really seeing is a system hugely under pressure and probably at crisis point.
Yeah, thank you. Anthony?
Just wanted to make a connection, if I may, with the Feely report in terms of the analysis and the critique of what has or hasn't worked well in terms of health and social care integration. Mm-hmm. And I think the Feely report quite clearly indicates that despite all the efforts that have taken place with IJBs, councils and the health service, we haven't yet in Scotland been able to make that system shift towards community-based preventative services. So yes, there's more activity going on, but we haven't got the full range of preventative services that are taking place. I think if we look at the local authority funding, it probably doesn't necessarily give the overall picture of the pattern of how funding works and operates or needs to shift across the health and social care system. There's clearly an awful lot of work still to do to get the shift of some of the NHS services to support community-based provision. So it's a broader issue than just local authorities here.
Yeah, thank you for that. And just finally on that preventative question, and I know you don't go into this in the report as such, but do you think it would be helpful to have a specific, almost ring-fenced preventative budget? Because most, I don't see that many opportunities currently for spend to go directly towards preventative projects, because we are managing crisis, be it in social services or in homelessness services or mental health services. So just wondered what kind of your recommendation would be then towards that shift towards preventative, because if the resource is not there, then the projects don't happen.
Yeah, I mean, I think you're right, Miles. We don't reference that directly, I don't think, in the report. But my instinct, based on the evidence we've seen across the last few years from the Commission and in Audit Scotland's work, is that I wouldn't necessarily say a specific pot for preventative work, but just linking it to the freeing up and the letting go of the overall funding envelope for local authorities would give them the ability to choose whether they wanted to spend on preventative, because at the minute there's so much directive control over spend across the wider piece, not just education and social care, but elsewhere as well, but primarily focused on education and social care. And if there was that freeing up or that letting go, then that would give local authorities the ability to choose whether they wanted to spend significant sums on prevention. Now, if they choose not to, they choose not to. And that's the difficult conundrum, I think, and position we are about to potentially come into with a partnership agreement and a new fiscal framework. But I think that's, you know, from the evidence we've seen over the last recent years, that's what local authorities want. And I get a sense that the Scottish Government are moving there slowly as well, and that we might see a change in that regard quite soon.
I think there's little doubt that greater flexibility would give local authorities more scope to invest in preventative services. I think the other point I'd just like to say is sometimes it isn't as clear-cut as prevention or failure. Mm-hmm. You know, services meet lots of different needs. And so I think it's just a bit of a complexity about the terminology we use here that we just all need to be conscious of.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for that. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Miles. I'm now going to bring in Ivan McKee.
Thank you. And just so I can resist just to follow up on that last point, I think it's hugely important. Talking about that social care spend in the context and preventive spend in the context of local government, but of course it's the health service that feels the pain from that. So and accepting that the IJB model's not delivered on that. So I don't know if you want to comment on how that could work, because clearly all of that, right back to ambulance queues, is a function of social care not delivering.
One of the messages in the overview report is the importance of local authorities working with partners, both public sector partners, the third sector and communities, to deliver change. And I think what we're seeing in our work evidence gathering for the overview report is many local authority chief executives and their health partners and their partners in enterprise agencies and others see the only way forward in terms of delivering sustainable public services about working together. you know, more seamless approaches to the use of funding, more place-based focus models of service innovation and transformation. So I think that whole systems approach, if I can use that term, Mr. McKee, does seem to be the way forward. Now, we know that's not easy, and we know that the level of trust, the level of shared understanding, the level of shared priorities vary enormously across different parts of the country. But if we take an optimistic view of the world, we've also saw during the COVID-19 pandemic that local authorities and their partners could do fantastic things where they had a shared vision and they were working towards a common enterprise. Obviously, we don't want to go back to the difficult days of the COVID-19 pandemic, but if we can maintain some of that energy and focus, one would have some hope, I think, that some of the change that we know is needed, that transformational change, will happen. It ain't going to be easy and straightforward. They've got to keep the show on the road. They've got to empty the bins. They've got to keep educating kids. They've got to continue providing social care services whilst making change happen. But I think in the better and more progressive local authorities with their partners, I think we are seeing some quite interesting thinking. I think we reference in the overview report the work that was done by the Improvement Service and Solis on a new operating model for local government. There are some very radical ideas there. I think it's fair to say that almost all of the things that were in that report are being done to some degree in different bits of Scotland, but in no part of Scotland is anybody doing all of it at the level that's required. So there's a real need there, I think, Mr. McKee, to see this not just as a local government challenge, but as a public sector, community and third sector challenge.
OK, I suppose that brings us nicely on to the things I was going to ask about, which was exactly that, on embracing radical change. What does that look like? You might want to get some examples of that. And how does that play out in terms of councils working more closely together and with other public sector partners through shared services, back office, sharing premises, etc. Certainly, when I was in government, getting Scottish Government to talk to local authorities about sharing space was something that was an interesting challenge at times. In both directions, and then I suppose following on from that, the implications of that for workforce. But maybe I was just starting to talk about the radical ideas, what's out there, what needs to happen, what can happen, and how we move it forward.
Sure. Well, it's interesting because we just recently had a joint event with the Improvement Service, where we got some relatively newly elected councillors in, and we asked that question: you know, what's the barrier to that sort of change, that radical change? Mostly the answer was political, sometimes with a small p, but if there was no political alignment across different local authorities, or, as I say, with a small p, sort of clashes with those in another authority area, then it just didn't seem to happen. There are occasional examples of cooperation. Two of the Ayrshire councils cooperate in roads. There's been economic development, cooperation between Borders and Dumfries and Galloway. But there isn't just that more radical, wholesale kind of change that would provide efficiencies. And just joining up a couple of areas we've talked about, it's interesting that a lot of the staff shortages are in highly professional areas. And quite often what happens is somebody might get poached from one authority to another. If there was a more joined together approach with some of these shared professional services, there might be an opportunity to, if you like, take that poaching pressure off and allow all authorities to have access to those specialist resources. Whereas at the moment, sometimes the smaller authorities really struggle to attract those highly skilled professionals.
Sorry, did anyone else want to?
You're asking for examples of where we see innovation, and I think we probably need to look a bit beyond the shores of Scotland, if you like, to see that. If we look in other parts of the UK and beyond, perhaps into Europe, we see examples of shared leadership, shared governance and combined authorities, which provide greater flexibility for the planning and deployment of resources. We haven't really seen that yet in Scotland, and I know you're taking evidence from Reform Scotland later. I'm sure they'll have a lot to say about this in terms of different models of configuring, planning and delivering public services. These things aren't straightforward. They do require political and managerial leadership. They also require a burning platform for change. And it seems to us that burning for platform is perhaps now there, so we may see more of this happening in the future.
Yeah, I mean, I might be naive, but I would have thought the fact that local governments are short of money, and we know they're short of money because they never miss an opportunity to tell us they're short of money, would be the burning platform that would persuade people to talk to their neighbour about how they can do things better. But what you're saying is you're seeing very little evidence of that on the ground.
I think what we're seeing is an increasingly lively conversation about the need for change, but the plans to make that change happen and what that might look like in practice perhaps is less well developed. We see lots of examples of very good innovation, transformation at local level, but I think, to use a the oft-repeated cliche, not necessarily at scale. So it's the scaling up of these things that perhaps is a challenge at the moment.
Is there a role for Scottish Government not to mandate but to guide and direct and help share best examples on that and indicate what the art of the possible might be?
I think there's a role for the Local Government Improvement Service here. There's a role for local government itself, I think, to be better at sharing, challenging and driving the change that they require.
I would think, Ivan, that there is a role for the Scottish Government to be, you know, an advocate for this type of change, for sure. I mean, without wishing to contradict the discussion we just had about, you know, releasing some levels of direction around funding, I don't think it is contradictory, you know, to make that case and to see the evidence we've gathered over the years around that case, but in the same breath to say that, yes, you know, why shouldn't the government be an advocate for that type, the type of change you've just been discussing with Anthony and colleagues, I think that there needs to be a caution about not financially directing it, because then that would be a contradiction to the rest of the tenor of what we've been debating. But certainly, you know, in terms of advocating that type of change, along with other partners like the Improvement Service and many of the lobby groups, then
would
be helpful.
Yeah, on shared IT systems, shared services, on sharing estates, etc.
Yeah.
Some of the evidence we took from Jackie Weaver, the famous Jackie Weaver, about the role of community councils down south was interesting, because one of the points she made was that with more empowered community councils and parish councils in England, they were taking on services at a very local level, then they could deliver those much more effectively and cost-effectively than local authorities could. And I see it in my own constituency, with community groups taking on community halls, etc., etc., and making them work, whereas the council couldn't. Is that an area where you see scope as well?
It's already happening. I mean, I think we see countless examples of asset transfers taking place under the community empowerment legislation, and I think it's generally accepted that the notion of making decisions closer to the people that use services is a good thing. So the community empowerment legislation provides for some of this, and we are seeing that happening in practice.
Yes, I think it's an extension of the principle we're arguing for local authorities, for decision-making and money to be put there. It's a further extension of that. Whatever the correct word is, non-pejorative word, up to the local community council level.
Concentrically, perhaps.
Concentrically.
So the last point on workforce and the commitment in the RSR, or the intent in the RSR to get back to the size of the public sector workforce, back to pre-COVID levels, implications of that for local government. So just in terms of how that's playing out, but also, I suppose, specifically to understand the extent to which this is looked at through the lens of, I suppose, comparing different councils in terms of how efficient they are at using the headcount they've got and how they deliver with a given headcount or a given cost certain services. I suppose also the balance between what you might call frontline and what you might call back office or management or supervisory type roles. And is there any work happening to compare which councils are most effective in that regard?
I think over the long term, the best value reports are where you get that information, because that's what we look at, performance and, if you like, value for money, although that phrase isn't used. Best value is what we call it, but basically how well are they doing given the resources they're employing. But Carol may want to...
I was going to come in on that. So the public sector reform agenda was to reduce the public sector wage bill, to reduce the headcount. I think that's been moderated slightly now, and it's now about slower growth in the workforce. what we're interested in is how councils are using their existing workforce to best effect. So they haven't got the money to recruit. The competitive market out there means it's difficult to recruit. The pay differential between the senior officers in council and the private sector is such that it's not an attractive option. So if you can't recruit your way out of the problem, what can you do? What you can do is to make sure that you're using your workforce to best effect and you're innovating around that. The Council Commission have asked Audit Scotland to do some work over the next year to collect information from every single council about how they are innovating to use their workforce, how they're increasing productivity, how they're increasing well-being, reducing sickness, how they are engaging with communities about what services need to be provided, how they're how they're increasing sort of training and development and generic roles. We saw how fleet of foot the councils were at the beginning of the pandemic, with the workforce being deployed in very different ways. How's that being built on now, and what does that look like? So we will be speaking to all 32 councils to get some information around that and pre-producing a national report, but that won't be until the end of 2024. So many things on the work programme, working out when they're going to be, they're going to come to fruition. But that is certainly something that we are very interested in, because the recruitment challenge is a kind of a macro challenge. There are market pressures, labour pressures. There are funding pressures on individual councils. The cost of the workforce has gone up. The inflation increase on the workforce bill. So it's what do we do with what we've got rather than get more.
Yes, and the labour market isn't going to get any less tight. Average public sector wages are still higher than average private sector wages, but it is absolutely going to continue to be a challenge. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Ivan. Mark.
Thanks, Kavina. Good morning. In the Accounts Commission's local government overview 10 years ago, talked about council involvement and performance improvement and governance is crucial. But I just wanted to ask on the experience of leadership in councils by councillors, whether that is actually driving councils to improve performance, become more efficient and effective, because whenever I talk to councillors, particularly longer serving councillors, they talk with real regret about their councils being more officer-led than councillor-led. So just ask your reflections on elected members' leadership in councils.
Thanks. I think that's very pertinent, because it's an issue we've been focusing on more and more. And when we do our best value reports, it's one of the areas we look at. And in fact, we're starting a new cycle of best value reports. And as part of that new process, we're producing a thematic report. So Carol talked about a workforce thematic report we're doing. Before we do that, we're actually doing one on leadership. So the next cycle of best value reporting will very specifically include a look at that leadership. And by the leadership, we're talking about the elected member leadership as much as officers. So we'll be looking at that question. My own feeling is that scrutiny has improved over the last 10 years, but I'll defer to colleagues who might want to give more detail.
I think if we look across the suite of best value reporting over the last 10 or 15 years, Mr. McKay is absolutely right, we have seen improvements in scrutiny. But it's also true, and I think Tim said this in his introduction, that we see variability in the leadership of elected members of local authorities, and there are risks, we think, given that variability, amongst whether or not local authorities will have that drive to transform and deliver sustainable public services. So it's something we will be looking at very closely in the next cycle of best value assurance reports. There is that degree of variability, and I think we mentioned that in the introduction, Mr. Griffin.
And do you have any indication about why that variability exists? Is that structural issues or purely personnel issues?
I don't think there's any evidence it's a structural issue. I think it's more, the evidence would suggest, I think, it's to do with the individuals concerned, the level of support and training that they have, the culture that develops with the individual local authorities, and the ability of the local authority to regulate itself and improve itself.
I think, Mark, there is something, if you look Anthony's references over the last sort of 10, I mean, I've been on the commission for 5.5 years, so I've only seen sort of in detail 5.5 years of these the best value reports for individual local authorities. But looking back further, but certainly over those last 5.5 years, there is a huge amount of discrepancy between the quality of elected member training across local authorities that's on offer to, not just on offer to local elected members, but then the volume of which is taken up. I mean, often the offer can be good and there's very little take-up, and sometimes the offer's not so good and there's good take-ups. So it's very, very variable. And certainly, just from my understanding and knowledge of the last 5.5 years of reports that I've seen across the 32 authorities, there could be a big improvement in consistency in terms of the offer in, as regards elected member training, which you would sense would be of help in improving leadership qualities across local authorities.
I'm interested in the kind of lack of take-up that you something mentioned, and well, the training could be good. You know, is that down to the pressure that councillors are under? You know, they're often managing second jobs, fairly high committee burdens and casework. Do councillors have time to take up the offer of training while that training offer might be very good?
It's a very valid point, and it's a really difficult conundrum. You know, there's a couple of ex-elected members sitting in front of me just now, and you know, we understand those pressures. You know, many elected members do have other jobs, and you know, without wishing to go into the detail of the argument, it's an incredibly difficult political capital P political argument to have, but there is an argument and a debate to be had about whether local elected members are remunerated highly enough. That's a really difficult avenue to go down. But you know, when you compare and contrast their salary, dare I say, with your salary or the convener's salary, there is a huge difference. And that does have an impact on what people can do when they're elected members at a local level.
Yeah, I would echo that. And I understand that Angela Leach is doing some work on a review of councillors' conditions, but I would echo Andrew's point. It's a really, really difficult job being a councillor, and if you're also expected to be a leader and your remuneration really is only half perhaps of what you need to live on, it's incredibly difficult to attract people. I'm amazed, when we had this event I was talking about a couple of months ago, I was amazed at the talent of the people that we were talking to. And I thought, goodness, thank goodness you've put yourself up for that. But if we really want to continue to attract that kind of leadership, I do think we need to, the government needs to think about the remuneration that they get.
Okay, thanks for that. To move on to another area, and Carol, you touched on absence as well, and you know, I know you talked about that planned work. I just wonder if there's any indication. Already, the sickness absence level in 21-22, I think, was the highest on record. Whether that is purely pandemic driven, whether that's driven by, you know, the burden that we're putting on council staff, asking them to do more with ever diminishing resources. If there's any early indication before you start that detailed work on why the sickness absence level is at that level, and whether you expect that to come down as we ease out of the pandemic.
Well, we're easing out of the pandemic, but we're also dealing with the cost of living crisis, and as you've said, issues around vacancy rates and recruitment of staff. So staff are under more and more pressure. Staff, we've been told through the improvement service, are burnt out, they're exhausted, and there hasn't been a pause since the pandemic. So I think that is part of the issue. The other issue is the pressure on staff when the resources into those smaller services are cut, so there are fewer people doing more work. And I think one of the other things that the Improvement Service raised was that there's sometimes the sickness absence level is affected by the waiting times for treatment in the NHS. So some people are off longer term for longer than they used to be because of that. But I think that we've seen over the pandemic and since, is that there are more people retiring earlier, so there's more economic inactivity in the population than we've seen before. So that means that the people who are working in councils are under more pressure. If you have those recruitment challenges, and you're falling up, that's falling on fewer shoulders to undertake that work, and they're exhausted shoulders following the pandemic. No break before we're into a cost of living crisis, and the difficulties in that. And also some of the workforce will have been pushed into poverty through the cost of living crisis as well. So the pandemic didn't affect the population and not the workforce. The workforce are absolutely as affected by the cost of living crisis and the pandemic as everyone else. So I think it's the multiple factors that have built up to that. We would hope to see that that comes down in time. Councils have got a very clear focus on wellbeing initiatives to try and support people back into work, to support people not to go off sick in the first place, and more flexible working options around hybrid working and so on to enable people to have better work-life balance. So there's a lot of activity going on in that area, but I do come back to a point I made earlier, which is that the HR and OD functions in councils have been cut because of those services. The back office services are the first to be cut, but they are the people that will be training the workforce of the future, planning what that workforce looks like and supporting people to be well in the workforce as well, in the workplace.
Is it even going to be possible to deliver some of the changes that we're talking about with a sickness absence level, you know, at the level as it is right now?
It's difficult, and we recognise that in the report. We said that this radical change is not easy, and particularly not easy with an exhausted workforce, and asking that workforce to think differently and do things differently. So it is going to be really difficult. My colleague Lucy was wanting to come in on some more other detail.
I was just going to say around the sickness absence levels, Carol's touched on all the reasons they're high at the moment, but actually that's a continuation of a long-term trend that's it's slowly been creeping up for at least, close to a decade. So there was a dip during the pandemic, which was probably a reflection of different ways that was sickness was recorded, but actually it's higher now than it was pre-pandemic.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Mark. I just wanted to... I've got a number of kind of mop-up questions here, but I just wondered on the well-being part, Carol, is there any consideration around a four-day work week? Has there been any looking at that?
Some councils are looking at that and other ways to kind of upskill, retrain generic roles, all sorts of things, and that's why we were particularly interested, and the Commissioner particularly interested in that we do some work to actually understand what councils are doing, what innovative approaches they're taking to try and improve the workforce. So, yeah, watch this space. We'll be producing some more on that.
Good, brilliant. And then I wanted to come back to, I think it was when you were responding to some of Ivan McKee's questions. One of the things that kind of came up for me was, you know, you mentioned about the opportunities for a Community Empowerment Act and how that's really brought about communities doing asset transfers. But I also wondered if our upcoming community wealth building bill could bring in more opportunities for that collaboration you're talking about around procurement of goods and services across local authorities. I wonder what you thought about that. Anthony, you're nodding.
I'm nodding in agreement. There's certainly potential opportunities there for that to be quite a force for good if it's planned and implemented effectively. I think the Community Wealth Building Bill also ties into the broader agenda that many local authorities are focusing on around things like 30-minute neighbourhoods and more sustainable approaches to not just procurement, planning, service delivery. I think these things are all interconnected, Convener.
And I wonder, this might be a radical idea for reform, but I was in conversation with somebody about forestry, and every time we spoke at length, and I would say several times during that conversation, it came back to local government reform. That's what this person said. And one of the things was the piece around local authorities owning more land, and the idea that, again, tying into the community wealth building agenda, that if local authorities own land, say perhaps for forestry or agriculture, which is, you know, maybe a radical idea because I don't think we do that. We tend to kind of look at that at a more national level. But we've been talking here today about the need for a more local, nuanced approach. So they kept coming back to that's an opportunity for certainly forestry. If a local authority owned forestry, that could be an income generator for a local authority. It could also be the timber that goes into building the housing. I wonder if there's been any thoughts around that kind of approach. I know we've got the common good land, but I think that's kind of evolved in a slightly different way. Certainly locally to me, it's a golf course. A lot of it's a golf course rather than other things.
We're not aware of any specific discussions or activity taking place around forestry or land purchase or land use by local authorities. But I think what we do detect from our discussions with chief executives and others is a strong interest in the kind of the well-being economy, and that's that desire to understand what the needs are of individual communities, understand and connect with local businesses in ways that are more sustainable. So I guess land use might form one part of that, but I'm not aware of any specific activity in that space at the moment.
Thanks for that. Anybody else want to come in on that? Andrew?
Just briefly to add, Convener, I think it's an interesting idea you've just raised. I'm also not aware of any of the rural authorities that are significant landowners in terms of potential for forestry. But I do know that several of the urban authorities are significant landowners and have, mainly through their economic development functions, have gone through quite protracted programmes of developing land, but not as regards forestry. But if it can, and it does occasionally happen in urban authorities, why not in rural authorities going forward? It's an interesting idea.
And one of the things that I'm aware of, being on the Rural Affairs Committee, is that there are these regional land use partnerships where, certainly in my region, the Highland Council is involved in that regional land use partnership, so it feels like it's another step in mm-hmm. that direction of looking at that mm-hmm. that land use. Yeah.
Just one final point, though. I think, given the English experience of some councils basically investing in businesses but then getting their fingers burnt, I think there is some caution still out there because of those examples.
I think that's very good to highlight that. I mean, one of the things, speaking of English councils, that I'm aware of is that we've got these inshore fisheries and conservation associations, I think they're called. I'm not sure what the A stands for, but in England, there's actually the kind of overview of the inshore water is managed at that more council-based level. And I think that's a really interesting model, something that we're struggling with probably here in Scotland around that kind of local stakeholder input into our inshore marine space. And certainly that it's not just about fishing, it's also many, many other people are involved in the inshore waters, and that's quite interesting, that approach in England, and that it's tied to a local authority. Maybe not, again, I think it's not necessarily appropriate to take models from England and kind of just sticking plaster them over what's going on in Scotland, because we have a different structure to begin with, but just interesting to look at that. Mm-hmm.
Just going to make a point that I intended to make when I was responding to Mr. McKee earlier, which is I think one of the things we're all very aware of around the transformation and reform agenda is that the model that will work in one part of Scotland will not necessarily work in the part of Scotland. So the notion of trying to apply a unified or identikit model across Scotland probably isn't the way forward. I think that's well accepted. I think the downside of that is it can lead to variability, it can lead to concerns about, you know, postcode lotteries, for want of a better phrase, and different models. But it feels it's one of those inherent tensions in the reform agenda. And when you're talking, Convener, around roles and responsibilities of local authorities, I guess part of that conversation around the New Deal might be what's appropriate for one local authority area or one region, maybe different from another.
Yeah, I think I totally take on board that idea that we need a nuanced approach. I think some of it, I think, is to do with the fact that we've got many, many islands, a lot of coastline, a lot of big rural areas, and then we've got a high concentration pattern in the central belt, so there's definitely a nuanced approach. And I get a sense that that's different from other parts of the UK. There's not so many islands, just for a start, so we have a very, very different set of issues just right there off the bat. Okay, I've got one more question, which is around housing. So your report expresses significant concern about the record numbers of children trapped in temporary accommodation, failing homelessness services and chronic shortage of social housing across the country. And we'd be interested to hear how can local authorities respond to these immense challenges. Anybody want to pick that up?
Carol, do you want to?
How can councils respond to this? We're going to be doing some work around homelessness for the Commission in the next couple of years, so we might be able to answer that question more fully at that point. But I guess the issue with the capital programme and the impact of the pandemic on the building of new affordable housing, there is a new affordable housing target. We did a piece of work on the last affordable housing target. We did a performance audit. It was joint with the Commission and the Auditor General, and that looked at the meeting of that target, which was met in time. The pandemic kind of took them off track a wee bit towards the end. But the main thrust of that report was about, it's not just about a numbers game. It's about what's needed and where, and how is that housing being built that reflects other policy objectives around poverty, around disability and access, around heat and homes and energy and fuel poverty. So the interconnectedness of those policies was largely absent in that last strategy to build more affordable housing. The new strategy does pull some of those things together. And I suppose the councils have a role along with other RSLs in ensuring that they know what the housing need in their area is and that they can build in a way that is meeting that need. So it's the type, the size, the location. And looking forward to net zero and changing, and you know, not having gas boilers and maybe having charging points for cars and all of those things, looking forward rather than developers being able to produce identical houses very quickly on an estate. Now, there's lots of barriers for councils to be able to do that because there are barriers in terms of land availability. There's barriers in terms of the infrastructure that's required and the services that are required around housing. And there's barriers about the availability of developers who want to work in those areas. But the capital projects have all been impacted by the pandemic. But there's a lot going on, and we will be keeping a close eye on monitoring whether that target is going to be met. But as I said, the Commissioner is quite interested in looking at something around homelessness, because we know that homelessness figures have increased since the pandemic, and the number of children. There was a blog that was done by the Auditor General and the Accounts Commission recently on homelessness and the impact of people and the numbers of people in temporary accommodation, the numbers of children in temporary accommodation. So there's a lot of information out there. So we're monitoring all of that happens, and then trying to see where we can fit in with something that helps shine a light on where does the spend go in all of this. So a lot of money is tied up in keeping people in temporary accommodation. And that's not because councils want to do that, it's because of the lack of available suitable accommodation. So, it's certainly on our agenda.
Thanks for that. That's really helpful, and we'll keep an eye out for that work that you do. And it's clear that it's more than just housing; it's the full kind of support package to help people. One of the things that has been flagged up to me, certainly in my region, in conversations about housing, and if I talk to people about affordable housing, and they turn back to me and say, "Actually, we need housing that people can afford." So I think it'd be good to have a look at that. You know, what do we mean between? And we discuss it at the committee too. I think that's something we're looking at: what is affordable housing, but what is really housing that people can afford at a local level, where salaries may be very different across the board, income. And I think the other thing that we've been looking at is the housing need and demand assessment, and you know, is that fit for purpose? And I think you pointed there that the importance of councils really understanding the need in their local area to be able to bring forward the right type of housing. So thanks very much. I think it's been a really super morning. Really, really, really helpful for us, and really appreciate that. I now briefly suspend the meeting to allow a change of our witnesses. Well, we now turn to agenda item 3, which is to take evidence from Reform Scotland on its Devolving Scotland initiative. The attention is that this session will allow the committee to further explore issues relating to the ongoing review of local governance and will build on the success of our recent joint event with Scotland Futures Forum on the future relationship between local and central government in Scotland. And we're joined for this item by Alison Payne, who's the Research Director at Reform Scotland. And I welcome you to the committee.
Thank you.
And I'll start with a few questions and I'll bring in colleagues. So at some point you previously said that Scotland is unusual internationally in the weakness of its local authorities, and I'd be interested to hear why you said that and how Scotland's local democracy compares to other parts of UK and Europe.
Thanks. I think we've previously sort of commented about and was referenced earlier that sort of the finance powers of our local authorities in Scotland are considerably weak. I think, as was mentioned this morning, sort of on the continent, 40 to 50% of the revenue raised is raised by the local authorities. I think we don't have complete control over any of our revenue streams, whether it's council tax or non-domestic rates, and indeed the 2002 Local Government Committee actually recommended devolving in full non-domestic rates. The rents, fees and charges is about the only area of finance where local authorities do have that degree of flexibility, and then you end up with the sort of the huge variation that we see where, whether it's to do with music tuition or other issues that become more contentious, because those are the only opportunities that local authorities have to try and raise some revenue. I think we also have a sort of strange system where there's often a lot of discussion about the number of local authorities in Scotland, where we either have too many or we have too few, depending on who you speak to, but nobody seems to agree that 32 is the right number. So, for example, Highlands Council is quite often put as a ridiculous setup, where it's hugely different what's going on in Nairn versus what's going on in Inverness. At the same time, Clackmannanshire is often used as another example of an area where it's very, very small. But if you were to look to the continent, there are far smaller local authorities elsewhere with multiple tiers or spheres of authorities where they're raising more revenue, and it just seems to be part of more of the what has been and has been the case and part of the culture of having that kind of mutual partnership working. The powers are passed down, the powers are respected, and the idea that things can be done differently. One of the things that I was really struck with from the Futures Forum report was the comment about accepting and respecting the decisions that are made, that they might be decisions you disagree with, but they're made and they're democratically accountable. And I think I also thought it was particularly interesting the report mentioned that that's as much for opposition politicians as it is for central government to respect those decisions. And I think what we have seen, perhaps, since devolution is that this sucking everything up, whether it's to do with workplace parking or city entry charges or whatever the issue is, it's kind of been viewed as at a national level rather than views at what is right as a local level. So the latest one being the workplace parking, how you fund it or pay for parking in its city centre in Glasgow versus rural Moray is completely different, and it should be allowed to be completely different and having that ability. And I think it's that sort of taking a step back and allowing those decisions, and we've not quite got there yet.
Thanks very much for that. I mean, one of the things that strikes me, you mentioned non-domestic rates as something that had been recommended to be devolved, but my understanding is there would be concern if you got variation for businesses that maybe had businesses in lots of different councils, that would be a difficult one for them.
But then equally, there will be companies that work across the border and might be in Carlisle and in Dumfries and Galloway, and you're looking at the Scottish and the English business rate poundage. So it can be done. Yes, companies are always going to say that they want simplicity and only want one. And I think the business rate review made that point and how it was, it'd be better if it was simplified. But if you took it to its logical conclusion, you would have one rate for the whole of the UK. So I think there is variation, and it's also accepting the differences about what's going on in our different local authority areas and the different economies of our different local authority areas.
Thanks for that. That's really useful insight. So we've been doing quite a bit of work around understanding the barriers to local elected offices, and I'd be interested to hear Reform's perspective on what more could be done to help Scotland's councils be more representative of the diverse communities they represent and what needs to be done to improve councillor remuneration pay? Had a hard time getting that out. I absolutely agree it needs to be improved. I'm not sure why I stumbled on that question.
We would totally agree with that as well. I think, as we've pointed out before, you can have people that are running our cities that are earning less than an MSP, and it's not to say that there's one is better or worse than the other, but it's more about that parity of esteem that we already spoke about. If you're running a major city and you're not well remunerated and you're thinking about your own pension or your future and you're having to juggle something else, we're not necessarily attracting the best people. And then even if we can start beginning to attract a more diverse group of people to stand for and get elected to local authorities, what we're often finding is they'll only do one term, because the actual reality of juggling this is that they leave. And so I think that there is an awful lot that we do need to look at about the terms and conditions of councillors. I think when the last reforms around the voting system were brought in and there was an increase in remuneration then, but it's still considered a part-time job. And I think in reality, it isn't. I mean, speaking to councillors from years ago where you didn't have emails, you didn't have the same amount of correspondence and issues to deal with, they don't have the support staff, there's a whole load of issues around, say, pensions and other elements that aren't there. How do we build up those expertise if people are finding it's simply not a sustainable option?
Thank you for that. Yes, I think definitely something needs to be done, and I know that the SLARC is busy also reviewing the remuneration piece too, so hopefully that we'll see some progress on that, because it absolutely what you say, you know, the fact that somebody is responsible for the City of Edinburgh, for example, and is being paid and considered as a part-time level, that is concerning.
It's a difficult issue, of course, because obviously then going to the electorate and saying, you know, politicians need to be paid more is never a popular manifesto pledge. But I think there needs to be a broader understanding of what our councils are responsible for. And actually, if you increase awareness and understanding of the importance of our councils, increase the understanding of, you know, they're responsible for your schools, for your roads, for the people would want to have those expertise. And I think there does need to be some work done to try and explain and help people understand why, yes, we are talking about paying politicians more, but it's important.
I would say also probably most people don't understand. I don't know what the salary is at the moment. I think it's around £19,000 a year or something like that. And I don't think most people really understand that that's how much a councillor, a straight-up councillor gets as their salary. I'd be interested to hear what reform Scotland would like to see in the forthcoming legislation. We've got the Local Democracy Bill, and also I mentioned the previous session, the Community Wealth Building Bill. What do you think are the opportunities there?
I think certainly a lot of the issues that were discussed already this morning in terms of the fiscal framework and the sort of longer-term financial planning are key. I think actually properly reviewing our system of local government in terms of the boundaries, in terms of the numbers, the functions. There was a discussion earlier as well about the sort of the financial powers. There needs to be far greater discussion about and acceptance that what we're going to do. It's not simply a case of, yes, we've talked about replacing council tax, then we've talked about a local income tax, then we talked about whether we'll have a citizens' assembly to replace the council tax. But actually, instead of replacing one centrally dictated tax with another centrally dictated tax, why can't we allow local authorities to develop their own local taxation? What works and what is the best way for dealing, whether it's second homes in the Highlands or a land value tax somewhere else, or what it works in the different areas? And I think it's certainly around about, definitely there needs to be, if we're going to reform local taxation, but bringing local authorities into that so they have that power to reform themselves. There are different issues that we have referred to in the past in terms of, as I've mentioned, the sort of finance side of things, whether there are things around looking at directly elected mayors or provosts. An issue that we've also spoken about that we would like to see, and again, there was reference made to the Australian Council of Local Government in the Fiscal Futures paper, but something we've talked about that we'd like to see is a sort of quarterly meeting between the sort of First Minister and leaders of our councils, a public kind of gathering where there is that sort of parity and you can talk through the delivery and the different options. So if if central government is setting out what they want the outcomes to be, there can be that public discussion about, well, how it's delivered in one area isn't going to work elsewhere, and learning from each other. And I think that would also be a very positive view to helping the public see our local authorities in action. So I think there's a range of the sort of structural bits, but then looking at the powers, are there ways that we can pilot certain things to give more responsibility to local authority areas, looking at areas where there's coterminous boundaries? We're seeing the mess that is the National Care Service around what's centralised, what's not, what's going back and forward at the moment. But are there ways where we could look at where there's coterminous boundaries between health and health boards and local authority areas to try and improve joined up working? Can we give local authorities, say, responsibility for health in places like Fife, where you have those coterminous boundaries, where we can try and actually better join up the issues around social care and health and bring those in? But I think ultimately a lot is going to come down to the financial arrangements, and it was very telling, as the Accounts Commission and Audit Scotland said earlier, that if you really want to look at the preventative agenda, it is about that longer term financial planning. And I think the prevention agenda is so key, and that we do need to start looking beyond, you know, we can't fix something in 6 months, we can't fix something in 12 months, but the reality is we're not going to fix something over an electoral cycle. And actually start looking at those longer term issues. You know, how do we start fixing and looking at the longer term?
Thanks for that. That was good to hear. You had talked about boundaries before, but then you unpacked that piece around the coterminous nature of some in some places. And again, that brings back that whole nuanced approach that we need to be looking at. I'm now going to bring in Ivan McKee.
Thanks very much, and thanks for coming along this morning. Just to touch back on something you mentioned earlier before I go into the questions I've got. You mentioned the workplace parking levy. I just want to pick that a wee bit in the context of government should let local authorities get on with stuff. So I suppose, and I'm wrong, but I'm pretty sure that's an enabling piece of legislation to the effect that allows local authorities to do that. So is the point you're making that we need more of that to allow local authorities? Okay, right, okay. Yeah, because the discussion on that, the narrative on that, ends up being a narrative at Scottish Government level between the different parties about whether it's a good thing or a bad thing, rather than local authorities taking that first. So that's the point you're making. Just wanted to clarify on that.
Yeah, I think that's across the board. I think it's across all parties that instead of it being the Scottish Parliament shouldn't have been discussing the workplace parking levy, it should have just been done as an enabling piece of legislation, which everybody seemed to accept that they want more enabling legislation. It was then up to 32 local authorities to argue it out as to whether they introduced it. Yeah. And as I say, what's right in Glasgow is going to be different to Murray.
Yeah, realpolitik gets in the way, unfortunately.
Indeed.
So, yeah, I mean, just getting into the substance of this stuff. Obviously, you've opened up this debate with Jack McConnell heading that off in terms of the system and structure, and that was pointing very much into the space of are the current boundaries and that kind of structure effective. So just to explore that a wee bit and any of your thinking on that, you've mentioned interface between local government and, for example, health boards, but then that opens up another question: is the health board structure correct or not? Which is another whole subject. Clearly, there's stuff that can be done at a more regional level, if you like, with either restructuring or local authorities cooperating with each other. But also, we've taken evidence on what happens at a more local level, community planning partnerships and community councils, and clearly an issue about is there more that can be done at a very local level. So what's your kind of thinking on that? Is there a need for a multi-sphere system in local government, or can it be done in the existing kind of structure but with more flexibility around about how things are done?
Absolutely. Potentially, just to go back a bit and to give a bit of background on the Our Devolving Scotland Forum at the moment is because we're wanting to try and attract in as wide a range of individuals to kind of think about these and get, so there will quite possibly be conflicting ideas, but wanting to have those discussions and those debates around what it is we should do. But one of the things is, as Jack McConnell mentions in his opening piece, is the fact that it's, you know, we haven't really reviewed the boundaries. We've never really looked at what was done in 1993. And indeed, the original white paper called for 28 local authorities, and we ended up with 32. We've never really looked at are those the right boundaries? And we've never really considered, well, what was the reason we went from two tiers or two spheres to one sphere, but then we've created all these differences where some things are too local, some things are too big, and there's so much in that. And I think the key thing, as you say, is the enabling different areas to do things differently is key. Because undoubtedly, particularly in the central belt, you've got your economic regional areas where there's so many overlapping things when you're looking at economic development. But in places like Highlands, where you have the very rural and the city, and how do you ensure that each voice is well represented? But then equally in somewhere like Aberdeenshire, where you've got the rural areas, but you've still got the more urban. And so what we're sort of saying is, look, we want to be discussing this. We haven't reviewed it. It hasn't been looked at. It's happened, you know, 30 years have gone past. We've had the constitutional reform in terms of the Scottish Parliament. We've left the European Union. There's a whole load of things, but nothing has changed in local government terms. And I think looking at, well, are these the right boundaries? Could we do things better? Are there things that voluntarily councils can come together? And the sort of the discussion earlier about shared services, and how can we encourage things to be done on a more shared service basis? But equally, how can we ensure that things are done more, on a more local level? And as I said earlier, the discussions, nobody seems to think 32 is the right number. Plenty of people think it's too many, and plenty of people think it's not enough. But yet, to kind of, we'll say, well, if nobody agrees, we'll just stick with it and we'll not review it and we'll not consider if things could be done differently. And I think that's what we're trying to encourage, that debate, and get tease out, well, what are the different things? What could be done? And then also enable that sort of step backing, so it's we move away from the discussions of postcode lotteries and we begin to realise, well, it's local accountability. There's difference there, but it's accountable, and it's local accountability that's driven it.
Yeah, I'm old enough to remember when the politics of that period, and I suppose, I don't want to go into it too much, but it was done for perhaps reasons other than what was an optimal solution to local government boundaries. I think Mike can want to talk about this a wee bit more, so I don't want to jump too much in that space, but I suppose there's a number of kind of tensions here between what happens, what's get done at a more macro level, what's get done at a micro level, what is postcode lottery versus local control and how you navigate that. But also, I suppose, there's a big question where it looks at this, thinks, yeah, maybe it's not the right answer, but frankly, the amount of work and cost involved in restructuring it is potentially a bit scary and kind of backs off. And I suppose there's a question about how much can be done in the existing structure. But I think we're going to pick that up later. Yeah. Okay, so I'll stop there. Okay.
Thanks very much. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Good morning. Right. Alison, it's really interesting to hear your thoughts and views on a number of issues. What about the New Deal? Could you give us some thoughts and reflections about what you think may should be in there? And could you maybe offer us a suggestion or two about how we get the flexibility argument, how we improve that so that local needs can properly be served and paying regard to national structures and national directions that very much drive it. You're not alone in being asked this question over many committee meetings, but I'd be obliged if you could give some of your thoughts on it, please.
I think the New Deal, in terms of the New Deal, I think it would be fantastic if it actually began reflecting some of the things that have been set out in previous reports, like the Christie report or previous local government committee reports or the blueprint for local government, some of the reforms that are there, and explaining, you know, how do we enable the prevention agenda to be developed. And I think key to that is finance. And I think the drip feeding in terms of little bits of finance won't work. It actually needs us to empower our local authorities to enable them to have the financial powers to look at what works for them. We can't be doing things like we're saying, well, you've got council tax, but we're going to cap it and we're going to ring fence your budget and we're going to create an absolute headache and then expect you to deliver how we say we deliver. And I think the starting point has to be that sort of partnership, that it's about, to quote Derek Mitchell, who has written a piece for Devolving Scotland Forum today, who said, the symmetry of outcomes, not delivery. And I think that sort of, if we're starting from scratch and having a new deal for local government, it's about looking at outcomes and not the delivery mechanism, and enabling councils to deliver different in different ways. to reflect those local circumstances, to find what works in their area, to not be afraid of not failure, but things won't always work. And that's okay, because the only way that we're going to find what works in different areas is trying, and what works in Dumfries and Galloway might not work in Moray. And so you can't just pick up and say, right, well, that works there, so we're going to roll it out. But actually allowing the local authorities themselves to develop their own pilots, to develop their own delivery mechanisms, to say, right, well, if we want to reduce homelessness, for example, and set that as the outcome, there will need to be different, you know, 32 different approaches to delivery. I think certainly that the fiscal framework, though, in the New Deal is key, and I think that sets the tone. If you are really trusting the local authorities, then you are giving them the financial powers to, maybe it's the beginnings of a journey, but to looking towards that 40 to 50% of raising their own revenue, and how they can then encourage growth in their area. They can encourage economic development, they can encourage scaling deep in terms of the entrepreneurialism, but then looking at what are the issues in their area, whether it's they have an issue with homelessness or have a different education reform they're wanting to tackle, but something that is more precedent in those areas. Because the country is really diverse, it's facing huge demographic challenges, but they vary hugely across the country. I mean, Edinburgh's demographics are going to be okay, but Inverclyde is a huge problem, and it's enabling them to therefore address those. And I think it is it's enabling. I think just like the workplace parking, it's enabling legislation that allows local authorities to, rather than having to keep come for mission and say, well, we've thought of this, we've thought of this, but to develop their own strategies and not always come, kind of have to come cap in hand and ask permission of the Scottish Government.
Fascinating. How local should it be to devolve power, let's say? Take my constituency, Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley, something like 16 towns or villages in there, including Kilmarnock, of course, but none of them have any powers whatsoever for the town or village. Absolutely none. Should it go to that level? I mean, the only structure I can think of, Alison, is the community councils basically represent villages and towns, small towns and villages, but have very little powers. So are you talking about an agenda that really breeds new life, new power at the local level, for at the town and village level? Is that something that you're...
Definitely, but I would say it could be done in across different areas differently. So somewhere like you're talking about in Kilmarnock with the different villages, the developing the community council system there might be more appropriate than it might be in some of the other areas. I think there's definitely issues around community councils where in some areas they're very active, they hold regular elections, they're well understood and there's good participation. There's other areas where not only do they not have elections, there's not enough people standing, there's not enough people wanting to get involved. And I certainly think there's something around about, well, how do you generate that interest? How do you ensure people have an understanding of what's going on at that very, very local sphere? Quite often it's a local issue in a small area will kick off that that kind of interest, but then that can get it elsewhere. But I think it can be done in an asymmetric way. Just because it works in one area, you know, the growth in somewhere like Kilmarnock might work, whereas other areas there's less interest, but that's okay. Mm-hmm. I think that would be the way to look at it.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for that. Just switching to non-domestic rates, council tax, trying to fully devolve them to local authorities. There have been some attempts in the past that have never came to fruition, haven't there? I was certainly part of a review, and I think it was two parliaments ago, that was looking to replace the council tax. It just didn't happen. We couldn't get agreement round the table for a model that we felt might work. So how realistic is it? Is it too complex? Is it beyond us? Or is it something we should keep working at?
I think we need to keep working at it. I think just a bit like the number of local authorities we have them only because nobody wants to, we don't want to deal with a difficult decision. So we've still got council tax, it's still based on 1994 kind of house values. There's so many issues and problems around it. There was, you know, as you say, going way back, the discussions about the local income tax. But I do think there's an issue around one centrally imposed local tax being replaced by another centrally imposed local tax, which doesn't really fit anybody. And I think that's why we would like to see local authorities having the ability to set their own local tax so that you could have one local authority keeping a council tax, whereas another one decides to develop a land value tax. And building that system that works for their local area so that they properly fully have the full powers devolved down to them and they have full control. So you don't end up then having introductions of things like council tax caps and all the issues that we've had and seen around about those, the different times that they've been done. And I think it's giving that full responsibility to the local authorities. So yes, you might then end up with 32 headaches, but then you might end up that some start developing their own system, and it's a gradually slow process, but others will take that opportunity and say, right, okay, this doesn't work for our area. We're going to develop, the Highlands going to look at a land value tax and it's going to work, and they start doing it. And then you begin to see reform and others learn, because councils can then learn from each other and see, well, that worked for them, but might not work for us, but we could look at what's happening elsewhere. And just having that variation, I think, is important.
Okay. Thank you for that. You talked about the 32 councils. Can I pin you down? What does Reform Scotland think? Should it be higher or lower? And how do we get, that transformational change that you're talking about? Can we get it within that 32 council structure, or does it need to fundamentally change to help deliver that?
I think we can get transformational change. I don't think it can be delivered tomorrow. I do think it will take more than one election cycle, and I do think it is key on that sort of preventative agenda and kind of looking at implementing Christie. In terms of the size and structure of the local authorities, Reform Scotland has often argued over our years that we would like to see more powers devolved down. And one of the criticisms that we got, so for example, before the police were merged, we wanted to see the policing powers devolved down to local authorities and the responsibles. You can't do that with 32. So then we did at one point publish a report that said, look, if 32 is too many, we made a suggestion that if you had 19, you could get coterminous boundaries with police, with healthcare, with looking at a whole load of sort of strategic areas. I'm working on that basis. But then it goes back to where is the right sphere? And I think what we do need is we do need the boundary commission, and we do need more of a kind of investigation as to, well, what powers we want and how we're going to have that managed. I mean, as was alluded to, the 1993 settlement was largely down to politics. There's the discussion about, you know, why the boundaries were drawn and what the reasons behind them were. It makes it more even ludicrous that despite that being the reason that those boundaries were created, we still have them sort of 30 years later. So why is it we've got a sort of a very small Clack Manningshire and we have a huge Highlands, or we have the sort of Dumfries and Galloway and Fife and some massive areas and very small areas, Angus and Dundee? So I think it's actually looking at the boundary commission, looking at what powers we want, where do we want powers to settle? So could we look at bringing in healthcare powers to our local authorities? Could we, instead of having the health boards and our local authorities, could we look at bringing those things together? So it's, I guess, a case of starting with what powers you want to have, and then what's the most the best way. A boundary commission review could also consider, well, did we properly look at why we had two tiers of authorities prior to 1994, and the reasons for why we went to unitary authorities? Are there certain things that, you know, we would rather have at a sort of higher level and some at a lower level? Do we want to have two tiers again of local government? Are there some elements of that? Now, again, that creates other problems, because if we're trying to attract councillors and we want to pay them more, you're then creating more councillors. But I think it's having these discussions and involving the public in those discussions, how they see their local authorities, what they want, what do they identify as their local authority area? Even sort of some areas like East Lothian, which is quite small, but has various different sort of bits, whether it's Haddington or North Berwick, they're sort of individual communities that don't really join into, there's just a boundary that's been set there. So I think having that conversation, and part of what we're wanting to do with the Devolving Scotland discussion is kind of try and tease those discussions out and kind of have more of a public hearing and sort of get the ball rolling so that we can move to actually reforming what we have.
So that was 19 then, was it?
It would depend on whether... I think we have never sort of said... Because I think there's an awful lot of powers that we would want devolved down. And I think almost sort of starting at the position of, like, it should be devolved unless there's a reason for it to be reserved to Holyrood. But I would favour the... And I think we have certainly favoured... smaller number of local authorities, a larger number of smaller local authorities, but we gave the 19 as an example of here's one way to do it. If you think 32 is too many, if you think more than 32 is too many, this is another way of doing it where you could get rid of the health board boundaries. We have not sort of said this is the ideal number.
Right. I mean, it's the reason behind it. The number in itself doesn't matter. It's the reason behind it. Something like too big, too small. Yeah. Too much power, not enough power. That's the argument and the dynamic that's going on here, isn't it? And somewhere in there is an argument about how we localise power to the greatest effect, to the benefit of the communities we serve and all of that. And that's why I mentioned the villages and town level in Kilmarnock, Northern Valley. There's no power whatsoever in any of those units. And it would be the same for everybody's constituency. None of their towns and villages have any power whatsoever. They act as an authority in regard to just about everything they do. So thank you very much for your comments. It's much appreciated. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks, Willie. I just wanted to pick up, before I bring in Miles with another layer of complexity with his questions, a few things. One struck me while you were talking. You mentioned actually at the beginning, and also it was mentioned in the previous session, around the fact that in the EU, local municipalities, or they can raise 40 to 50% of their revenue at a local level. But I just wondered, you were describing quite a picture of a potential Scotland with a lot of diversity, and is there that level of nuance in other countries? In France, I realise I've got a bit of a fixed picture of, oh, it's 250 people around a mayor or whatever. But is it quite diverse depending on the geography and the local issues?
Yeah, I think there's quite a lot of the sort of the differences, and I think Spain, for example, where you've got the autonomous communities and the what goes below them, and the asymmetric level of devolution of powers, there are differences, and I think it's just it's always been the case that there have been that sort of the very very lower, and particularly in France with very low level local mayors, and how you sort of there. It's just expected that, and in certain areas as well, you'll have elections for a lot of sort of public office. That is the norm. In a lot of the sort of Scandinavian countries, again, you've got some that have got smaller levels, some who have shrunk down the number of local authorities, some who have increased the number of local authorities. But it's the sort of what has worked for those areas. And I think, again, it's the geography can come into play as well. And I think that's the thing. In Scotland, we're not looking at kind of a sort of an area of that can be easily the same, one size fits all is not going to work. I think, as you mentioned earlier about the islands and things, there's very, very different solutions that can be brought into bear. And I don't think we do need to find this is how we're going to work, and it's going to be exactly the same across the country. I do think we need to kind of be more nuanced in developing solutions, that it's going to be, okay, it might be really, really local in one area, it might be more strategic in another area. If it's right for the area, if it's right for the population, it's how people identify. So if people identify as that, you know, they're from Glasgow or they're from a small village in Kilmarnock, that identification is also an important part to bring into it as well.
You're bringing in a kind of an element of belonging in a way, isn't it? I was interested to hear from Jackie Weaver when she came to our session a few weeks ago about the fact that community councils in England have that, they're incorporated and they have that revenue raising power that ours don't. And I wonder, it kind of comes back to also the conversation of remuneration and how do we engage more people? How do we get our community council? You know, what would be the incentive for people to come to a community council? And it would seem to me that, well, actually, if you're a thoughtful person who wants to participate in shaping that place that you belong to, you identify with, that actually having some power to do something could attract people, and the same with at the council level, having that remuneration piece, because then we would attract people who have the kind of skill sets. I mean, we already do, and they take a massive cut and then struggle financially, but as you said earlier, tend to do one term and then have to move on, which is a shame, because then you've got a tremendous amount of experience over that five-year period that goes out the door again?
Undoubtedly, and I think in particular when it comes to community councils, ensuring representation is so vital, because there is a danger that you end up in some of the areas where they're not, that you don't have elections, and it tends to be people that are perhaps retired or have more time on their hands are not necessarily representative of the community, that are therefore managing community councils. And it may only be that when an issue creeps up that there is a divergence between perhaps local opinion and a community council, that there's more interest. But I think that's another layer of problems, because, you know, within a cost of living crisis and all the other issues that we've had about money, we can't, there's so many spheres of government that to keep increasing remuneration for increasing levels of politicians is not going to be a popular policy.
I mean, we met last week, we had a very useful meeting with our counterpart committee from Wales, and they were telling us that there they've got what they called joint committees, corporate joint committees. They've got four of them, and they kind of have a bit of a regional approach. Now, they were saying that it don't quickly adopt that, but it was an interesting thing that they've got, obviously a smaller size, but they've got that regional approach for some aspects of decision making. And it does seem to me that it comes to, where are we putting, you know, what needs to be decided at a bigger level, mm-hmm. and what needs to be decided at a more local level, and, you know, starting to decide what's the decision making domains that we're going to, that comes back to that clarity, I think, that was called for at our New Deal event with the Futures Forum, and so that clarity of what decisions are going to be made about what things, and what makes sense to do it at a bigger level, because we need a regional approach for that, maybe roads, for example, and then a more nuanced approach at a more local level.
Yeah, I think the thing is that the problem at the moment is that we've not really got anything down at the local or the very local level. Everything's kind of centralised.
Yeah.
And I think we need to shift away. So, yes, there are a lot of decisions and discussions that we need to have about how local is local and how far down we go, but we need to shift away from everything being centralised. And I think to address the cost of living crisis, to address the demographic challenges, to address all the things that are coming down the line, to shift to that preventative agenda, we have to first deal with everything being centralised. And I think that needs, the New Deal is the opportunity to address this, to sort of saying, look, you know, we're taking a standoff. We are shifting from telling you how to deliver things, giving you the money, ring fencing it, and saying how you have to deliver the central government's priorities. We have to shift to these are the outcomes. And then, in the same way that central government needs to release the hands, then it'll be up to local authorities to say, well, what's appropriate and what can we devolve further beyond that. But local authorities can't devolve anything at the moment until that's been devolved from the centre.
Something that always comes back to me in terms of the issue around how do we get more people to engage with the community council. I made a note, how local is local? We need to have that conversation. I think we maybe have a talk about that here in the committee. But universal basic income, it's not necessarily ideal, but I do wonder if that's a way through in terms of getting more diversity at that very local level in a community council, because people would actually have some foundational income to then be able to, you know, serve their community from.
Absolutely. I mean, Reform Scotland's published on a universal basic income. We've argued and set out. It's certainly expensive, but we have recommended and sort of said that it is something that should be considered. And indeed, all welfare power has been already devolved to Northern Ireland, so there's no reason why it couldn't be devolved to Scotland, which would then give us more of a situation. I think at the moment, with the powers that rest in Scotland, one of the things that we found is, whilst it could perhaps be piloted in Scotland and working in partnership with the UK government, that without the full welfare powers, it's difficult to do on a Scottish basis alone. But then if those powers were devolved, then there would be opportunities to develop those things. I do think, though, with the at the community council level, it's not just the money, it's the time constraints. And if you're wanting to get in a diverse selection of people at that level, people will also be working. They will also have care responsibilities. And even with a basic income, it's how do you get a diverse selection of people in? One of the things that's happened in some councils recently is where council meetings used to happen in the evening, which, of course, removed a lot of people from being able to participate. Community councils tend to be in the evening, so that is a barrier. So it's looking at the time element as well, not just the financial issues.
I think that's a really important one to point out, but I think also helpful to hear the, you know, maybe the need for some powers that have already been devolved elsewhere that could come to Scotland to help us with that. Okay, now I'm going to bring in Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ali. Thanks for joining us today. I wanted to discuss, and we've all touched upon another set of politicians to be introduced, but elected mayors and provosts. And just to get more of your thoughts on that, and just wondered if there was evidence around elected mayors actually increasing accountability, improving community engagement, and actually delivering better outcomes for people, and just your thoughts on what Reform said around this suggestion.
Thanks. I think we sort of use the phrase mayors, directly elected mayors, simply to distinguish between the sort of largely ceremonial provost that we have, but provost mayors, as you say, interchangeable. I think it's about the sort of the clear identity of who is in charge and that sort of person for the area. Now, the model that we suggested in our report was very much using existing council boundaries and having somebody directly elected across the council area. So not it's not really the same sort of system as the sort of different areas where we've got down south, where Andy Burnham, it's across the larger Manchester area. But just having that sort of understanding of the identity and have somebody who can represent as a voice for their area, but is also a voice locally, nationally, across the UK, but as a sort of ambassador internationally as well, whether it is for Edinburgh, but equally for Murray, which might not always have the loudest voice because it's drowned out by the Central Belt, but actually giving a bit more of attention to some of the areas that are perhaps overlooked. It's also about that kind of connecting up individuals. At the moment, we have most local authorities are run by coalitions. There's not always great understanding as to who is in charge. Some councils have had two leaders just to reflect the nature of the coalition partners. There's not always great name recognition with the leaders of the council. And of course, a councillor is just elected from one ward, not necessarily having that link to the full area. And so part of our thinking as well was to ensure this move towards that kind of the parity that was spoken about earlier. How do you raise the profile and the understanding and the voice of local authorities? Now, whilst the structures might be different down south, I think what we have seen with the likes of Andy Burnham is that name recognition, that kind of fighting for their area, and the Sadiq Khan and others where they are a voice for their area against a stronger central government. And I think that's what we're trying to do is kind of increase the voice of Civic Scotland, increase the voices that are out there, and have that sort of identifiable individual that can argue for their area. I think we saw during the pandemic when local authorities kind of came on, there was a bit of a better understanding because you could only move within your local authority area, and you know the which local authority was in which level for the COVID restrictions. I think we saw in those points some of the arguments that were going on as to were local authorities sticking up for their area or were they going along with their national party? And I think the key there is it's a directly elected mayor or provost is also somebody who's the people's voice rather than potentially a party's voice for the people or the party's voice in Glasgow or Edinburgh or wherever, as opposed to a strong local champion. Because if you just from whichever party, if you just spout party lines and stick very rigidly to what your party is saying, you're going to get kicked out. You're going to get voted out by the electorate. And it's about building that kind of that link. So it is about what is right locally. We've not always seen a kind of a disagreement between local authorities and their the sort of Scottish central parties. And I think we should be having more of that discussion because it's obvious, surely, that what is right in one local area won't be what a party leader wants to say. And I think that some of the discussions that have gone round about coalitions, for example, at local authority levels, where we've had parties saying, oh, well, you can't go into coalition with this party, or another saying, oh, you can't go into party. But we have a voting system that's designed to encourage coalitions. So it's kind of that sort of when the politics comes into play. So this is also a way of kind of stripping back a wee bit of the politics and giving voice to a local authority area.
Yeah. And in terms of powers you would envisage them having, what powers would you centralise to elected mayors or provosts or sort of civic leaders. And one of the things, and this is a leading question, I do think kind of hasn't been well managed, is around who's responsible for delivery of the city growth deals, which the UK government, Scottish government and collections of councils have signed up to. Because we've had big bang moments, big numbers for these. But then key infrastructure projects, and not far from here, there is Sheriff Hall Roundabout, which is still progressing like snail's pace. Huge key project for the Lothian region. No one's the lead minister on it or lead politician. So just wondered if it's more that sort of economic development you'd envisage, or powers actually around health, policing, sitting with this individual?
I would say definitely also health and policing and other policing would also look into the reforming the centralisation of the police. But yes, there should be more powers, and those would be passed down to. We would still envisage there being the council, and the council would hold the directly elected mayor to account. But the powers that they currently have, plus the enhanced powers that we've sort of spoken about, I do think that there is then issues such as, say, the Sheriff Hall roundabout, which is then covering more than one council area. Mm-hmm. I think that is a sort of example of other issues where there are the different spheres of government and who's to blame, what is happening, and it's not clear where accountability lies. I think that could be slightly separate from the mayors, because even on that situation, unless you had a different boundary, you'd have potentially three mayors. It's still not clear who is responsible for delivering that, and I think that is perhaps something that needs to be looked at with the city growth deals as to who is responsible, where does responsibility lie? Because as far as the public's concerned, who do they hold to account? Is it the UK government? Is it the Scottish government? Is it the local authority? It's not clear. And I think that requires some sort of clarity from politicians themselves to sort of say, well, this is the responsibility, we'll back off, but we'll hold you to account.
Yeah. And do you think it would improve the relationship between local and central government to have that additional tier, or are we just going to create another voice in that who either will be elected, let's face it, by a party which is in government or not in government for these areas, and political cycles might then actually dictate who's doing these sorts of roles. And like we see with Andy Burnham, you know, he'll happily, and Sadiq Khan, take on UK government. We would maybe have Conservatives elected taking on Scottish government here at this point in time. And so it's quite easy to have a dissenting voice if you're not in the government of the day. You're not necessarily progressing an agenda.
But then I think there's also been Conservative mayors that have taken on the UK government. And I think that's actually what we need a bit more of, is that, I mean, I think it was actually really good to see the discussion between Adam McVeigh, the former leader of Edinburgh City Council, with the Scottish government over the tourism levy. And more of those discussions we should be having, where it's clear that there's a local versus national debate. There should be disagreement. There should be that sort of public discourse. I don't see the mayors as an additional tier of government, because it's simply looking at the structure of the existing councils and how do we give greater voice to them so that they can then kind of have more of that sort of parity and equality with the Scottish government. And I go back to one of the other recommendations that we've made before is about this idea of having these quarterly meetings, where now it could be then, if we have mayors for everywhere, that it's the mayors and that the Scottish government, they could alternate between the First Minister or different ministers with different responsibilities, but actually talking and discussing and debating the different issues of delivery of the national objectives, that they're saying, right, we want you to deliver X, well, how are we going to do this? And enabling those differences to be discussed. And people learning from each other, but you've got then that platform where people are hearing the different voices, and the, you know, you have 32 local champions. But yes, I would want there to be that difference. And yeah, obviously a Conservative mayor is going to find it very easy to disagree with a national Scottish government, but it's the key bits are actually really interesting, is where it's within the same party, and that will happen, but it should happen more regularly.
Yeah. And just finally, and back to sort of Willie's questioning around council numbers, 32 elected mayors, like elected mayor of Edinburgh, for example, the amount of resource they would potentially have compared to elected mayor of Clackmannanshire, and the voice, you know, I think in terms of the cities, these would work well in terms of that real kind of economic driving opportunity to to promote an area, but just wondered where that having 32 had come from and not looking at potentially where we do operate more regionally, like in terms of Holyrood with Lothian Region, for example, and where councils would come together and have an individual rather than 32 and people being lost in kind of 32 voices instead of 8.
Well, I think on that basis, then, it's just that's adding a different tier of government. And so you're potentially then looking at two tiers of local government. I think what we had been proposing is it's also giving voice to... So West Lothian gets quite often overlooked when it comes to discussions because Edinburgh is the focus. The how do you increase the voice and the recognition of the issues that are affecting places like Mid Lothian and West Lothian, which are kind of swept up into the sort of Edinburgh economic area? And... if you have one person representing these sort of larger areas, Glasgow becomes the focus, Edinburgh remains the focus, the big cities remain the focus, and those hinterlands still don't have their voice. Mm. They have the council, so that's why we were saying, well, how can we amplify the voice? How can we make sure that there's a local champion for Livingston and covering West Lothian so that they are the issues that they're facing, which will be different to Edinburgh, aren't overlooked? And I think that's part of the issue there, is if you just make it round the big cities, then the focus will be the big cities. Mm-hmm. But we do know where the issues and the demographics and the housing and a whole load of issues are in these other areas. So how do we amplify those discussions? Mm-hmm. So I think with the 32 is what we have at the moment. So I think working with the 32, but go back to the previous discussions about whether we need the boundary commission, whether we look at what is appropriate, if should our starting point be something that was allegedly done to ensure that the Conservatives could hold on to some councils in 1993. It seems a bit of a strange situation to be in 2023, still sitting with that being our starting point. But I think certainly we felt that the mayors were not an additional tier of government. They were working with the councils.
Yeah, thank you. It's an area I think kind of is a lot more discussion going to happen across parties. So thanks, community.
Yeah, thanks for that. That was a very interesting discussion. I have a greater understanding now of what you're thinking behind that. Mark, you wanted to come in.
Thanks, Kevin. I just wanted to ask about essentially government and Parliament's ability to deliver, a new local government settlement, a new local government landscape. Now, we've talked already about essentially a public acceptance that the system we have just now is a result of political gerrymandering 30 years ago. And so you wonder, how can such a system have lasted for 30 years? And you think, well, one, it's because nobody agrees what should replace it. Two, that there is an inbuilt resistance. You have 32 leaders, you have 32 chief execs, finance directors, education directors who will be thinking, well, if there's a change here, is there a space for me? And also... The political makeup of Parliament and the entire history of Parliament, we have had minority or very small majority governments with limited political capital looking at an item that's probably not very high up the priority list of the public. So basically my question is, with all of that in mind, can government ever deliver the change that we would all probably agree at principle, maybe not at the detailed level, we should be pushing for?
So I think as we mentioned in our sort of submission, we point to the Local Government Committee of 2002, we point to the Local Government Committee of 2014, where a lot of these issues have kind of been raised before and there's kind of calls for change. It is difficult and it can seem like it's not a priority, but I think it's seen as not as a priority because it's not linked to change. How, if we actually empower local authorities, they can be the vehicle that delivers the better outcomes for our people. They can be there where the empowerment agenda that Christie set out can happen. So if we want to, deliver on Christie, as is still talked about, but if we actually want to deliver on that, we need local government form to enable it. And I think it perhaps requires a sort of cross-party agreement to take it on and sort of... accept that, the current situation doesn't work. We need to move forward. It's politically contentious. But then that requires kind of whether it's the government setting up a commission slightly outside of Parliament so that it can go beyond an electoral cycle, so that you can get the buy-in from the different parties. if everybody accepts the current situation is unsustainable, then it surely is not beyond the wit of politicians and Civic Scotland to fix it. But I think it has to have that buy-in, and it has to sort of say, look, well, we will, you know, have a commission that looks at this, that we will work out and get some sort of agreement, whether it's something modelled around like the Smith Commission or something, where you had the different agendas coming in, but coming out with some sort of solution. And then that can be that way forward. But it is really important. We need to, our local authorities are the ones that can deliver the change that we require. Constantly delivering one size fits all from the positions from the centre hasn't worked. And so I think it's incumbent on all of us to try and fix that, to move forward, to change and say, right, this is, to explain to people why it's important. It does seem like, you know, talking about more councillors or councillors' wages or these things seem very detached from improving the cost of living crisis. But if we can enable and empower our local authorities to deliver the early interventions that we need to look into the longer term solutions, so they're not working on 1 year budgets, to look at and take on all these challenges that we face, then I would like to think that it can be done.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much, Mark. I think that's interesting, and thanks for that positive response there. I just wanted to pick up on one piece, because you were talking about coterminous boundaries, and we're going to be going at the end of June to Orkney, which is a single island authority, and I just wondered if you had done any looking at, you know, what's going on there, because we also heard from Councillor Heddle at one point that they've actually given budgets to their community councils that are island, you know, in the kind of surrounding islands, so that they can actually make decisions at local level with some financial backing.
We haven't looked specifically at Orkney, but that sort of coterminous boundary is exactly the sort of thing we would say is, you know, could be piloted and looking at, instead of having the, you know, the Orkney Council and then having the Orkney Health Board, but kind of, can we bring them together? Can we pilot different things where we can bring more powers into different areas? It would make sense to give the islands a lot more powers, and certainly they've been calling out for them, and pilot certain things. If it is politically difficult to change the things, well, the islands and other areas, sort of Fife, Dumfries and Galloway, where you have coterminous boundaries, is an opportunity to pilot, to try and experiment. I think that rather than it being a big bang thing, try it in those areas.
Gradual reform rather than...
if that's what it takes.
Rip it all up. The other thing I wondered about is the Scottish Land Commission came out recently with a report, I don't know if you've seen it, around forms of tax... so not necessarily a land value tax, mm-hmm. but different kind of ideas around tax on land. And one of the things that was flagged up to me was the fact that you have a situation in Fife where you've got Amazon with their regional delivery. I can't remember what the name is, but anyway, they've got all their stuff and it gets sent out to not only Scotland, but the north of England. And they pay, I think it's £1 million in, would it be non-domestic rates, and the neighbouring Tesco pays £2 million. So there's something there where Amazon is generating tremendous income, but not really, you know, paying for it. So I'm interested in exploring those things. I think it's something that we will look at as a committee in terms of giving more power or, you know, generating more income for local authorities. But just wondered if you had looked at that at all.
It's not something that we've looked at. We've certainly hosted some ideas about, you know, annual ground rents and other types of land taxes and land value taxes. I think it's the sort of thing is what works in one area doesn't work in another area, and allowing that kind of more nuanced system to develop. And I think it is interesting to kind of encourage different ideas, and how do we ensure that things are competitive, but they're also fair. There's definitely issues around land banking and some other issues that can happen, which can stifle development in an area. If you were reforming the sort of taxation system, are there things that you could do around about there? But again, it's sort of looking at and giving the local authority the powers to develop those systems for themselves.
Thanks for that. That's really helpful. It's been a really useful session. I think we could go on a bit longer. I've certainly got more questions, but I've put a big box around my note here. How local is local? Maybe that's another bit of a conversation, because it seems to be that that's a piece. So how do we, if we want to take that forward, the 19, the 32, more local, that seems to be something that needs to And maybe that exists in some of the local government reports you've pointed us to, the work of the 2002 or the 2014, but it seems that that's another piece of what do we want to devolve across to more local levels, and I certainly feel that's important as we face a climate and nature emergency, mm-hmm. and there are going to be very different sets of issues, flooding, wildfires, whatever, that are going to be facing communities, and that they're going to need that kind of pandemic level speed of response to those issues. So, you know, what's that local level that needs that power to be able to do that quickly?
Indeed.
So that kind of opens something else up, but I won't go there.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Alison, for joining us this morning. It's been tremendously helpful. And as we agreed at the start of the meeting to take the next items on the agenda in private, and as that was the last public item for today, I now close the public part of the meeting.